Members of the House Judiciary Committee, having just voted, are starting to return to the hearing room right now. They're going to continue debating the two articles of impeachment against President Trump: abuse of power and obstruction of Congress. John King, let me start with you. How good a case do you think Democrats have made for these two articles of impeachment? Have they made the case? I'm not saying you have to agree with it or not, but to a skeptical independent, that the president abused his power and that he has obstructed Congress by not cooperating with the investigators.
If you have tracked along through the Intelligence Committee hearings and the public testimony and then the articles of impeachment now and here, I would answer yes. That does not mean it's impeachable. That's a separate argument, and you have to be a member of the House, and that's your vote. You get to vote that. Have the Democrats made a case that the president used his official powers, withheld a White House meeting, and withheld military aid in exchange for political favors that benefited him personally that had zip to do with national security? Yes, they have. Have they made a case that they have issued, if you accept Congress as a co-equal branch of government, that they issued subpoenas in a constitutional obligation or responsibility of the House, impeachment, and the president said no, absolutely no, didn't give them witnesses, give them, yes, that's all well documented. Those facts are actually not in dispute. The question is, you know, can they make the argument, especially with an election 11 months from now, that the president should be removed for this? So the factual argument of the Democrats is a pretty solid case. The political argument, should a president be removed? That is why I think we have seen sort of a stagnation of public opinion that makes it hard for the Democrats. Now, they believe the Democrats who say we have to do this, we must do this, we don't care about the politics, that's one thing.
It's a solid case for people who are really interested in learning the actual facts. And
have the time to do so.
Well, and have the time, but are not interested in hearing what they want to hear, which is the problem, increasing problem with our country and with society and with the media. And we can, you know, talk about this for 50 years about the, you know, how things have changed. But it is played out in such a stark way during this whole process that what John just described about what the Democrats are presenting in a world of, where people are open to hearing arguments that don't comport with how they want things to go, meaning Republicans don't want this president to be impeached or don't want to hear that the president did anything wrong. And that is the core issue. They're talking past each other, and the people out there who could be persuaded are not persuadable because they don't want to listen, or they're listening to people and media outlets telling them things that they want to hear.
Jerry Nadler, the chairman of the committee, Democrat of New York, just walked back into the hearing room, so we're expecting him to gavel it back into proceedings any minute. But Laura Coates, let me ask you the same question. How solid a case do you think the Democrats have made, not just to people who are paying attention to every word, not just to people who are political junkies or invested one way or another in the outcome, but just to the average American out there? How much do you think they're hearing what happened and actually are upset by it?
With respect to the second article of impeachment, they received nothing in return for congressional subpoenas. That is clear. You can check in for one half a second, and that's very clear to the American people. Whether you think that's enough to impeach is a different story. On the first part, it takes a little bit more of an intellectual exercise and also requires you, on an abuse of power, to look at context. And I think you have a losing argument trying to persuade the American public if this is the straw that broke the camel's back argument. Because the American people want to know in an election year, why this instance, why now? And relying on context requires you to do what? Go back to the Mueller probe, which did not have the benefit of witnesses like Ambassador Yovanovitch or Dr. Fiona Hill or Lieutenant Colonel Andrew Vindman, who were able to give a face to the actual allegations there. All they had was Robert Mueller, who, without a doubt, did not present the most exciting, energetic, charismatic of cases. And so when you have that, I think you have to worry as the American public about, well, what would be the motivation for members of Congress to say it's okay for the president of the United States to ignore subpoenas? If the president of the United States is the head of the very branch of government whose job it is to exercise and enforce the laws, that's the real clear issue. To me, it's never been about whether the case has been made. It's about whether or not Congress is allowing people to believe this is the time now.
I'm not a believer that incorporating Mueller in the articles or arguing it more would have actually changed the public view. Because if you look at the change in polling, it all shifted around the time of when we saw the whistleblower report, when we saw the transcript, and that was talked about. It was very simple. And actually, 70% of the public in many polls thinks the president did something wrong. It doesn't mean they think he should be removed and impeached, but they don't like what they see.
I'm going to sit on an indefinite hunger strike because I've had enough. In 3 years, Delhi Commission for Women, which is a statutory body, we've handled over 55,000 cases of brutality against women in Delhi alone. In Hyderabad, what has happened, the way the girl was gang raped and the way she was burnt alive. In Rajasthan, a six-year-old girl, in the manner in which she was raped in her school dress and strangulated, her eyes popped out. Whether it is the case of an eight-month-old baby who was raped, or whether it is all these cases, or whether it is the continuing news of all cases coming from all across the country, I think we all have had enough. The country lacks stringent mechanism to punish the rapists. Last year also, I had sat on an indefinite hunger strike. On the 10th day of my hunger strike, the center created a law in the country which said that from now onwards, at least rapists of children will be given very stringent punishment in 6 months. But even that law is yet to be implemented. There is a lack of police resources, lack of police accountability, lack of fast-track courts, and that is my demand, that a stringent mechanism which includes strengthening of all these aspects need to be set up immediately. That's a need of the hour. It is very shameful for my country that today the chief of a statutory body is having to go on a hunger strike because I'm left with no other option. The government only hears this way. They are not hearing my letters. They are not heeding to my various notices and action that we have done. So this is the only way that is left, and I'm going to resort to it.
Now, some politicians are calling for the lynching and castration of these rapists and murderers. What should be their penalty, and why is the justice system in India so slow to respond to these crimes?
Yes, the parliament is debating right now, and the parliamentarians, some of them are saying lynch them, some of them are saying whatever. But the idea is that you are the parliamentarians of the country. You are not there to express your anger and anguish. You are there to take action. You are there to force the central government to make very concrete and lasting changes. Delhi police right now is lacking 66,000 police personnel for the past 13 years. I think that is the need of the hour. Each and every police officer is handling 600 cases. How do you expect them to serve justice? Similarly, Delhi is lacking 45 fast-track courts. And the entire country, there's so many districts in the country which are not even having a single fast-track court. No police accountability is set. For the past 13 years, the center is trying to create a software to digitize the functioning of the police across the country, and that software is yet to be created. I'm a software engineer. It doesn't take rocket science to do that. So we are not talking about these parliamentarians. They're not talking about concrete issues. They're not trying to set up systems in this country. And it's really sad that all that they're doing is talking. I think I appeal to the parliamentarians, if you are not able to do anything within the parliament, please come out on the street, please sit with me, please go on an indefinite hunger strike, and let's get these systems created.
And explain something to me. What is it that's created this rape culture in India that men seem to think that they can do this to women?
People are not scared. People feel they can get away with anything. There are so many times that rapes have happened, and these rapes have happened by people who were out, who were already convicted of rape, or who were already involved in a rape case and were out on bail. So how do you ensure systems? Till the time, how do you ensure deterrence? Till the time there are no systems. So I think that whenever you speak to a parliamentarian or whenever you're speaking to a leader, people talk about the mentality of the people. I think that mentality of Indians by and large is pretty good. I'm sitting on this hunger strike. I sat on a hunger strike before also. There were thousands and lakhs of men and women who came to me and who said that they feel for this country. They don't want this rape culture. By and large, we are a God-fearing country. We believe in respecting women. But it's very unfortunate that few criminals are out in the open and the governments fail to nab them, to punish them, and to create stringent systems in order to ensure that there is deterrence in the country against rape.
New questions tonight about something the president said, words with violent overtones, and some believe a veiled threat of physical violence. Speaking to Breitbart News, he talked about how tough he says the political left is becoming compared to his supporters. And I'm quoting now,
the president saying, it's so terrible what's happening. You know, the left plays a tougher game. It's very funny. I actually think that the people on the right are tougher, but they don't play it tougher. And he continued, okay, I can tell you I have the support of the police, the support of the military, the support of the bikers for Trump. I have the tough people, but they don't play it tough until they go to a certain point, and then it would be very, very, it would be very bad, very bad. You have no doubt that was some sort of a physical threat of violence.
Yeah, I mean, I think on one level it's just kind of gross that the president of the United States speaks like that. But there's a much more serious part of this, which is he has undermined institutions purposefully since he's taken office, even when he was running. It's why he attacks the press. It's why he, even in 2016, said he wouldn't necessarily accept the result of the election. He said it again in 2018. These are things that undermine the base. I mean, the most amazing thing about our democracy is we have peacefully transferred power every single time. And what Trump is doing is sort of in cozying up to authoritarian regimes and then saying things like this, he's indicating that, well, maybe I won't. And maybe this isn't the way it'll work.